Mothership community, welcome back to First Frequency of Oneness, Shock Metaphysics. I am your illustrious host, Reverend Dr. Philippe Shock Matthews, a.k.a. the Metaphysical Morpheus, and it's Thursday. Of course, you know what that means. It means we get to talk to our crazy elder, the one that we love and the one that we need to celebrate, and that's Dr. Clyde Winters. And why do we need to celebrate Dr. Clyde Winters? Because he's in a new documentary that Brother Tariq Nasheed did. Welcome back, Mr. Celebrity. I should call you now officially, Mr. Celebrity Elder Winters.
Thank you, but I'm not a celebrity, you know. Let's not forget that it was a family. Remember, it was a family that asked Tariq Nasheed to put me in his movie. And
That's right. I remember that.
Yeah, it was the efforts of the family. They kept harassing Tariq. So. He relented, and I'm in the Maroon movie, American Maroon.
Okay.
Next week, family, Dr. Short. He's one of the leading characters in the movie. He's going to be on the show next week, and we're going to talk. We're going to talk about the American Maroon.
Wonderful!
Hopefully, you guys will show up and. You know, maybe we'll talk about how the movie was made, what we're talking about, and help you to understand more about this issue. Dr. Short is very interesting because Dr. Short, he's a Virginian. He's lived in Virginia a long time, and he has a lot of family between Virginia and the Carolinas. And you're going to find him to be a very interesting person. And he said that if everything works out, he's going to adjust his calendar and join us and talk to the family.
Fantastic. Hold on now, trying to get my camera adjusted here. Hold on, it's Ricky Tick fail. There we go. All right, so that way I'm not, my beard is all cut off from my lower third. Okay, so we'll talk about that next week because I love to go through the process of how you got flued. And how you flew out and did a damn thing. It was absolutely amazing. Yeah. I think last year, go ahead.
You know, what was amazing about it is the family had that type of influence. You know, Tariq's a very busy man. Tariq, he's made a lot of documentaries, and it was amazing to me that the family was able to go and contact him on I don't know where everybody went, but somehow they got him to include me, and that's something, you know. I mean,
absolutely.
Listen to the people.
Absolutely. So, it's kind of like this is going to another level, because I think it would be safe to say, based upon the brand that he has built, this movie will be in front of, if not, we already know thousands of people, but it could possibly well be millions of people. And that's quite exciting.
Yeah, it is exciting because they have it on a FBA screen, and you can just for an per month it's only $8.98. So if you don't really want to subscribe to the channel for a yearly basis, you may just want to get that 1 month so you can see.
Yours truly.
The movie is great. This is the first movie that discusses the history of the Aboriginal FBA, and also he does a very beautiful part on the Black Power movement. So many people, they don't know about the Black Power movement, and as a result, as I discussed earlier on this platform, is that many people believe that my generation, you know, the baby boomers, that we didn't really contribute anything to Black history, that we didn't really contribute and we didn't work towards anything.
Mm-hmm.
I talked to a brother the other day, and he said, "Well, you're no good. You baby boomers, all you did was take crack. This is it."
Wow.
Yes. Not all of us lost our pride in ourselves, you know, but many people did. Mm. There were many faces, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this week, a lot of people are surprised this week because, you know, we had an election in Chicago, Illinois. Lightfoot, Mayor Lightfoot, she's not going to be, in the running for the mayor because she didn't come in second place. And so, she wants to claim that she didn't win because of gender bias and that she, you know, she was a woman and racism. But that's not why. You know, I voted for Lightfoot in 2019 because I thought that she was going to be refreshing. But when she got in there, she became a tyrant. She's a tyrant. You know, she's going around telling me she got the biggest dick in Chicago. You're a woman. You're a female.
Whoa, she said that publicly.
You don't have a penis.
She said that publicly. That
she said that she had the biggest dick in Chicago.
Wow.
You know, and so wow. That was her attitude. Her attitude.
Oh my.
Her attitude was that she was going to be the power, and you know she was kind of really silly because they showed through the campaign that. That Vallis had a lot of support because Vallis is a Republican as a Democrat, and he has a lot. He got the support of the Chicago Police Union, and many of the white people on the lakefront. And see, it was the people on the lakefront that put her in office. But see, when she got in office, she didn't build a base. She didn't have a base. She just played up the fact that she was homosexual and that she was, that she was a gay person and all that type of stuff. And so she didn't have any base because, see, those people on Lake Shore, you know, and on the north side where the gay people and all the rich white folks live, they turned their back on it. And they turned their back on it because she didn't keep any of her promises. She said she was going to reopen a lot of the mental health centers. See, Chicago, Cook County, most of the people in jail are mentally ill. Because they're mentally ill because a lot of times people feel if you give them their medicine, they're not going to take their medicine. When they had those outposts, those mental health outposts in the community that were shut down by Rahm Emanuel, you know, that meant that at least people could see them weekly and could make sure they were taking their medicine. A lot of people aren't taking their medicine. You know, they're going. They're going buck wild. You know, they're threatening people on the trains. They're threatening people when you walk past them, and you know, because a lot of them are schizophrenic. When you're schizophrenic, if your mind tells you to do something, you're going to do it. Then we had a real good police chief. We had a low crime rate. She got rid of the police chief because she wanted to be the boss. You know.
Wow.
The police chief, you brought somebody in from Texas. He doesn't know what's going on with Chicago Police Department. He don't know what goes on here. And remember, he's the police chief who allowed them to use that robot to blow up that brother down there when he was they felt threatened, so you know. And so then she got rid of a good police chief when we had a low crime rate. Okay, and then she didn't want to get a police a good contract. She wanted to fight the teachers. And then she came about looking for teachers and everybody to support her. Then she even said that, last week that if anybody on the South Side doesn't vote for her, that's where a lot of Black people live. If anybody on the South Side doesn't vote for her, they may as well stay home. You know, but they wouldn't vote for her because she didn't develop a Black base. One of the big things she did is that, you know, they had all those immigrants. They've been sending up to Chicago from Texas and Florida. Then many people in Woodlawn, your neighborhood in Woodlawn, they had an abandoned school, and Lightfoot decided she was going to put a lot of immigrants over there. And so the Black people in Woodlawn didn't want them over there because they felt that a lot of the immigrants. A lot of those Spanish people, they might be stealing those catalytic converters and just causing a whole bunch of crime. And the people asked her not to put them over there. And the people that lived in on the lived in the Spanish neighborhoods, they were ready for them to come there. To the Spanish neighborhood, no, she's just gonna throw it down people's throat. See, that was her problem, you know. See, she by her being a dyke, she felt that, you know, by her being a dyke, she thought that she was a man.
I understand I understand that's what we call it. Your era and your age, but can we not use that word? Okay, calling them gay or LGBT or lesbian or whatever, that's cool, but I don't want to use epithets, because that's what we, you know what I'm saying, it's like I don't want to be that dude that labels people in that particular way, you know what I'm saying? So I know what you're saying, and I know you're very passionate about it, and I got that. But let's just call her what she is, you know, alphabet person or something.
She's the lesbian that wants to play the dominant male role.
I can see that. Okay. I can see that.
And so then what happened is that, so when she became mayor, she didn't understand. See, there's a difference between managers and pushers. You know, in factories, you have pushers, and these pushers, they're always on your back trying to make you get your production up and get work done.
Mm-hmm.
Lightfoot, she wasn't a manager. She was a pusher. She was a because of the fact that she was a pusher, she didn't get any. She didn't get too much accomplished. She was always arguing with the police, arguing with the teachers, arguing with everybody. So she didn't have any support. And because of the fact that she failed to have any support, she wasn't successful. You know, just like in Chicago.
What was her background, beloved? Was she a lawyer or something? What did she do?
She was kind of I know that she was put on the police commission, and she was she had made a name for herself being on the police commission. She came from Ohio. I don't think she had a background as a lawyer, but then you know she started attacking many of the progressives. You know. One of the main progressives is the district attorney in Cook County. You know, she's a black woman, and so you know Lightfoot was attacking her. But see, what they did is that they, you know, it was people in county jail who had been in county jail for 2-3 years, pay a $200 fine, and then you know, people say, what is $200 is a lot of money if you don't have anybody to give it to you.
That's right. That's,
you know,
right.
They made a study, and they found that the average American doesn't have $200 in their savings account.
Mm-hmm.
That's a blip. And so then what they did is that they made it so that in Cook County and Montreal, and they're trying to go against the bill. They've been trying to stop keeping people in jail for those little minor
infractions.
You know, $500, $200, all that type of stuff. And so then, you know, she was complaining about that. But the main thing about Lightfoot is that she became a tyrant. She became a tyrant. Mm. And she started, she didn't understand how to really manage people. You know, to be a good manager, you had to be able to encourage people to want to work with you. Then another issue here is that they found that 55 schools in Chicago, nobody in those schools, you know, was able to meet the math and reading standard.
Wow.
Yeah, and so then people upset about that, but see, I taught in Chicago for 46 years.
Mm-hmm.
And what I found is that in my school, until my principal died, I taught at Bennett Elementary on 101st and Prairie.
Mm-hmm.
And we had the top scores in the district. And not only did we have the top scores in the district, but when our kids got in eighth grade, many of them were able to get scholarships to some of the leading private schools in Illinois and Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
We were super bad. And see, one of them who were able to do that is my principal, Mrs. Ellis. You know, she listened to me, and I told her, I said, Mrs. Ellis, this is what we do. You know, I said that the majority of Black schools fail because most Black schools don't understand that in white schools, they teach the kids before they take their district and statewide tests. Mm-hmm. I said that what we had to do is we had to start bringing that, you know, textbooks in, and we should start in a sense to give our kids practice tests. So Ms. Ellis, you know, I was able to convince her that by January, we would change our teaching around, and that we would begin in a sense to give them practice reading tests and practice math tests as part of our math and reading instruction, you know. Mm-hmm. And so then so we could prepare them for the test so our kids were ready. Okay, what happened is my principal, she died in 2010. And it was a lot of people in the district. They was mad at they were kind of jealous of my principal. And they were jealous of my principal because of the fact that our school was so dynamic. Mm-hmm. I will admit it was because of me, but hey.
Of course it was. Of course it was. We all know that.
Oh hell. I got us a $300,000 grant, and we had a $300 grant. And this grant, you know, since I wrote it up, I put in there that that teachers could get $1,600, you know, per semester. You know, it's like first semester, second semester. And so then I was loved around the school. I also put in there where parents could get money. So the parents was making money. The teachers were making money. The kids were doing well. It was just beautiful. So we had that grant for about three and a half years. Okay, and so my principal died, Mrs. Ellis. She died in 2011. So they sent some other principals over there to take her place. Mm-hmm. And they all belong to the AKA, you know, Alpha Kappa Alpha, mm-hmm. you know, just like, you know, Kamala Harris. So when they got in there, I said, I went to Ms. Anderson. I said, one of the new principals said, I said, we got to start teaching and we got to start in January getting the kids prepared for the test. And so she said, no, Dr. Winters. I said, but we want our kids to get good scores. That's how we always got scored. No, Dr. Winters. Okay. You know, I used to, you know, she was so evil. I used to put salt outside my door.
You're so wrong. Keep the bad spirits out and the demons out, right?
Yeah.
He's so wrong. Oh, that's hilarious.
And she was our principal for a year. And she wouldn't let us use the practice test books, but she only lasted a year because they found out that she tried to change the test scores of the kids, and they found out, so she was fired. Then they brought in another principal, and she was really hateful, and she was a principal who had hated my principal because see, Mrs. Ellis was one of the highest paid teachers in the damn highest paid principal in the damn district. She's making $125,000, you know. Mm-hmm. So then when she came in, I went to her. I said, "It's January. We had to start getting the kids the practice test." She said, and so she said, "You better." She was an AKA too. She was an AKA, the district superintendent, the district head. She was an AKA. So then she came. So I said, it's time for us to distribute the practice test. And she said, Dr. Winters, you're not distributing anything. I said, but we want to get the kids ready to take the district test and the state test. She said, you're not doing nothing. And you know what the evil woman did? She got all the texts, all the practice test booklets, thousands of dollars worth of booklets, and she threw them all away.
Wow.
She threw them all away. All away.
Wow.
And see, because see, these.
Wow.
I'm only saying AKA because these three principals who destroyed our school were AKA.
Right.
So but I know it's good AKAs, maybe somewhere else. That's not a good AKA in the White House. Anyway, what they didn't understand is this. They didn't understand that If you teach kids a certain math strategy in September, a reading strategy in September, you know, then you teach them a new strategy by October, then another new strategy by December, you know, those kids are going to forget the strategy that they learned the month before.
Absolutely.
That's part of learning. When you learn, you also have to forget. And so, you know, what I understood is that if you get, before you take a test, you should practice. Mm-hmm. So that's why our kids were successful. But these are AKAs because of the fact that they listened to the white man. This is what white folks say. They thought that just because you had taught kids these skills in September, October, November, and December, then they would still remember those skills, but they wouldn't remember those skills.
Mm-mm.
So when they took the national test, when they took the state test, they got lower and lower. And before you know it, we were on probation. Our school was on probation. And you know, a lot of people in the district was happy because we were the top school in the district. You know?
Mm-hmm.
We were the top school in the district because we understood that. See, that's why these schools in Chicago, schools in I think Baltimore, that's why they're not doing it, because see, they don't understand that at the white schools, they prepare their kids to take the test.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I worked on the one year I worked on grading the parts of the district test.
Mm-hmm.
So I talked to a lot of other white teachers around the country, around the state, and they were having their kids do practice. But we had these AKA sisters who are running the schools in Chicago. They didn't want to do this, you know. And so then it's just a shame that our kids they didn't want to listen to me. They want to listen to me. And I mean, damn, I had a PhD. I was teaching at Governor State University, and I was teaching at St. Xavier's. I mean, damn.
Mm-hmm.
But see, I wasn't white. And because I wasn't
white. Also, you didn't play a JKA.
Hey, you're only
a woman. I'm being facetious. I know that. That's what I'm saying.
If
you had to put a wig and a dress on and some lipstick, you could have been AKA and you could have been transgendered and completely ushered in. That's how crazy the world is right now.
That's today.
Yeah, that's today. That's absolutely insane.
You know, and so then the only problem is that parents, in a sense, you know, you're getting paid all that money. I'll admit the principals, they may have been a little jealous because of what I was being paid at the time. I'm not going to go there. But I was making more than them. The Board of Education, and I had a PhD and two masters and 46 hours. So then I was making nice.
You were doing well. There's a comment from our brother. Both of our Melvins are with us. Melvin Wright, and brother Melvin Reed. But I want to put this on the screen. This is interesting because I think he's right. He says, "I'm sure that more kids were labeled special needs and district received more funding. So as a result of that, thank you for that, Melvin. As a result of that, do you think that a lot of these kids would be labeled special ed so that, you know, there's just more funding for that. What are your thoughts on that? That's a great point, Melvin.
I taught special ed for about the last 5 years of being in there. No, I'm sorry. Okay. The point is, Melvin, is that there's many federal and state mandates for special education, but they never provide the money. When they do provide the money, they take that money and put it into other programs.
Oh, okay. Okay.
You know, like that. That's why every 5 years, the Chicago Board of Education gets sued. Just like they just had a suit last year. Because they weren't meeting the needs of kids with special education. And they didn't have special education teachers. But see, they ran most of the special education teachers out between 2015 and 2018, because it's a lot of, you know, when I first became a teacher, you know, the teachers in the suburbs, they were making more money than teachers in Chicago. Mm-hmm. I was in my 20s. By 2015, the most highest paid teachers in the state were living in Chicago. And the reason that we were the highest paid teachers is because we had been teaching for a long time.
Right, tenure.
You know, so since we had tenure. See, in the suburb, I taught in the suburbs a couple of years ago. I taught in the suburbs during the pandemic. You know, I wanted to get some extra money for my social club. So what I found in the suburban areas that in Chicago, after 2 years, if you teach at the same school, then you would become tenured.
Okay.
Okay, in the suburbs, they made it 3 years. But see, what happened is that as soon as a teacher in the suburbs and even in Chicago in the 2000s, as soon as a teacher got near tenure, they would fire them. Listen to this. In Chicago, they would fire them. They would fire them that spring and then hire them back in September.
Really?
Yeah, because see, they did that because of the fact that by them firing you and interrupting your tenure, that means in a sense when they rehired you.
So it's like a restart, setting to put your car speedometer back to the. Wow, that's devious. Wow.
It's devious, but it's just.
Wow. That's crazy.
See, but a lot of parents, so you know, they can get away with that stuff. You know, the AKAs, they can get away with messing up a school district because of the fact that people take it for granted that our children are dumb. They take it for granted that Black children can't learn. It's not that Black children are dumb. It's not that Black children can't learn. It's just that they're not being prepared for a test. That's what a test is. Remember, a test is not supposed to be normal. You see? That's why, you know, okay, let's say they give you a fourth grade test. But that fourth grade test, a kid who can take that fourth grade test, if they good, they can maybe get an eighth grade score.
Mm.
That's not fair.
Mm.
It should just be a test to see if they understood the work for fourth grade.
Mm-hmm.
So then when you have a district where you got a bunch of AKAs running the schools, and these AKAs, they believe whatever white folks tell them, and these AKAs, they can hide. They can hide from any judgment. They can hide from any judgment because of the fact that, you know, Black kids not supposed to do well anyway in school.
It's not
that the Black kids can't do well in school. It's that we don't prepare our kids to take the test. It's very sad. And so then special education, they got a whole lot of recommendations. But see, the thing is this, they don't put enough money. When I taught special education, see, when you're a special education teacher, you're supposed to be a clinician.
Mm-hmm.
See, because of the fact that you're supposed to be a clinician, that means in a sense that you would, in a sense, get your students and you would provide a prescription for them to learn.
Mm-hmm.
Successful. But a lot of people in special education, even some of my colleagues, I love them, but I'll be honest and say some of them, they wasn't doing ish. They wasn't really trying to teach the kids, you know. And but I wanted my kids to be successful. My kids always did well. When I was teaching general education, you know, every year you may have been in school at the time. Every year you had to do you couldn't pass to seventh grade unless you passed the sixth grade test.
Mm-hmm.
Sixth grade for a number of years. And during that process, I never had one of my students. Over a 7 year period, I never had one of my students that didn't pass their Iowa test scores and the district test. But see, because of fact, in a sense, that I knew that you prepare them for the test. You don't have to cheat on the test. You just prepare them to take the test. That's right. Just in many states, you find a lot of Black people who can't pass the test to be a teacher. And the reason they can't pass the test to be the teacher is they may have had educational psychology when they were a sophomore. They may have took math teaching methods when they were a freshman. Maybe when they were a junior, they took reading teaching methods. Okay, so, but then they don't take in a sense the test to be a teacher until they get to be a senior when they're about to graduate. A lot of Black people in education, instead of them going back, looking over their notes from their earlier classes, they're going to take the test with no preparation. When they take the test for no preparation, they're going to fail. It's just like when you take the ACT test. That's a test to get into a college, or the SAT test. You know, the white people, they send their kids to get tutoring in that. So their kids get high scores and get into some of the better universities. You know, a lot of us, we don't understand that you have to put a little extra money in your kids' education if you want them to be successful.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So to get back to the beginning is that that Lightfoot lost because of the fact that she wanted to be a tyrant. She wanted to be a pusher instead of a manager. You see, you'll find that I've had many white principals and white supervisors when I worked in service agencies. What I found is that those Black women who were successful as and white women who were successful as principals or administrators, they always had a lot of men around them. You know, most women who are managers, they know that if you tell a man to do something, he's going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas when women tell another woman to do something, they always got a question.
Mm-hmm.
Can we do it this way? Can we do it that way? And so then a lot of times, that's why you'll find a lot of successful women they in organizations. They like to hire men because men do what they're told and they don't ask questions, you know. We know that if we don't get it done, you're going to fire us.
Right.
Where's that woman? She's going to want to question you and say, Mary, do you really think we should do it that way? Or can we do it another way? I don't know. That's just what I found over the years. You know, but.
Fascinating.
Well, it's just like.
So who's the new mayor?
They got to have an election there. It's going to be between Ballas and I guess some guy called Johnson.
Okay.
You know Johnson.
Are they Black or probably not? Are they?
Johnson is Black, and Johnson he's talking a lot of positive stuff. He's for the people, but most importantly, he's for Black people too. See that was Lightfoot's problem.
Let me ask you this, my beloved.
Go ahead.
When you know, I've seen this happen so many times throughout the years, and we talk about this even with law enforcement and policing. The people who go into these positions, you know, going after being a mayor or what have you, they all say, and I do believe some of them, not all of them, want to do good. They really want to make change. But when they get in there, the system is such that they end up basically handicapped and they have to go along and get along. That happens in law enforcement like crazy. But do you think that's also part of, is it that Lightfoot is corrupt or is the system corrupt or both?
Lightfoot, like the mayor in Washington, D.C., the point is this: it's not that she's gay, but she's following the Democratic agenda. The Democratic agenda today in politics is that listen to what Black people say. Yes, you need them as a base, but don't give them everything they want, because if you give Black people anything they want, then white people aren't going to vote for you. That's why. That's why the woman who was a mayor in Atlanta, that's why she lost. She could have got reelected, but she didn't want to develop a base. Listen, it's time we stop bullshitting. And here's the whole point. If you study the census, if you study the census data, and I and we talked about it on one of the shows, remember?
Mm-hmm.
I showed you how over a four decade period, they only said it was 10 million black people in the entire United States.
Right.
Okay. So then therefore, we know that according to the Constitution, when you count black people, you count them as only 3/5 a man.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, the census data is only gonna talk about 60% of the black people who live in this country.
Mm.
Therefore, since they're only giving you 60% of the black people that live in this country, that means that when you go and study any of the census, you have to add an additional 40%.
Mm.
And so then therefore what's happened is that black people are the majority in this country. That's one of the reasons why, if you remember, when the South Africans wanted to develop apartheid, they came to the United States. Why would the South Africans come to the United States and try to learn from the United States how to dominate a majority population?
Right.
We're supposed to be the minority.
Mm-hmm.
They came to the United States because they wanted to find out how to dominate a population that's non-white, that's the majority.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So then what happened is that you know, the mayor of Atlanta, she lost. You know, she highlighted all the Democratic policies. Support trans, support the LBGQ, support immigration, support immigration. Don't talk to the black people. Don't ask the black people. Don't get them shit. Mm-hmm. And so what happened is, when it was time to vote, they didn't vote for her.
Mm-hmm.
When the mayor of Washington, when she runs, she's gonna lose because the Democrats have decided is that if you give black people anything, white people aren't going to vote. But here's the whole point. Mm-hmm. We got to remember this. See, Obama became president not because white people voted for him. He became president because black people came out in mass to vote for him.
In mass, like never before in history.
That's right. And see, most of the time, though, we don't vote. Like, I didn't even vote the other day. You know, I may vote on Tuesday, but I'm going to go vote for Johnson because Johnson is talking about he has something that's a black agenda.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I'll vote for him because he has a black agenda. But see, as long as that's one of the reasons why Tariq Nasheed and the Black Authority and also Professor Blackett said is that black people should only vote if they're going to get something from the politician. Mm-hmm. That's why you vote. See, the Asians get plenty of money. They get the Asians what they want, right?
Mm-hmm.
AIPAC, those people in AIPAC, you know, they give a lot of money and they make and the government makes sure to give them good policies, and they even give money to Israel too because of AIPAC. Mm-hmm. See, even though many of the people in AIPAC vote Republican, Democrats support that stuff. See, so in other words, if you're going to be in any type of political situation, you vote based upon what you're going to get out of your vote.
Mm-hmm.
And see, and so then that's what happened with her, and that's what's going to happen to the mayor in Washington that's one of the reasons why what's her name didn't win in Georgia. You know how she lost to that white guy.
I know what you're talking about, the sister. I know with the twist.
One brother went to her and she said, one brother went to her and said, you know, it's a lot of black people, it's a lot of black businessmen that may would support you. Why don't you go down and talk to them? She said, oh, okay, I'm not going to talk to them. What did Kemp do? What did Kemp
do? He went down and talked to him.
He talked to the black businessmen.
Yep.
See? But the Democrats have told all the Democrats, don't give black people anything.
Mm-hmm.
Just give them lip service. They're gonna vote anyway. We're not doing that anymore. We're not voting just for for Democratic candidates. You see,
facts. We're
not voting for Democratic candidates just because you're a Democrat. We want something.
Peaceful.
And so then that's why, as again, as I said, I voted for Lightfoot. You know, I really hated that she turned into the tyrant that she did. But what she did is that she didn't have any base. She didn't even have a base in the gay community.
Wow. She really messed up.
Vote for, because she became a tyrant and she didn't have a base. I'll tell anybody out there running, build up your black base. That's why I'm very hopeful that Johnson can become mayor. I'm going to vote for him because the fact is that he has a black agenda.
Sure.
Everybody. But he specifically loves his people. See, this is what many black people don't understand. Many white people love other white people. They have pride in their race. But we believe that if we have pride in our race and that we support other black people, then therefore, you know, white people won't like us. They don't get mad at you because you love your people. They're people, you know. You know, yesterday I was talking. I called Dr. Short to ask him to.
I wanted him to come on the show.
So we got on a call with some other people.
You called him after I talked to you after our conversation.
What's that?
Did you call him? You called him after our conversation.
Yeah, I called him right after I talked to you.
Okay.
So, he said he would come on the show.
That's going to be exciting.
He made it. He brought some other people into our conversation because you know Dr. Short. He has a lot of contacts around the country. All that stuff.
Sure.
But then, one of the other people came on and they said, "Well, you're saying this Dr. Winters, you're saying that Dr. Winters." He said, "But we got Moors, we got Moors, we got Hebrews." How do you unify the people? I said, that's an easy answer. It's an easy solution. I said, what you have to do is that you have to say that we have an African ancestry.
Right. That's what connects us and unites us.
Nothing wrong with you being Hebrew, Moor, whatever. But the only way that we can become successful is to be what? Be one.
Right.
She said, how can we do that? How can we? I know I believe in FBA. I said, that's the whole point of being FBA.
I said,
foundational black American, you're not saying you're Hebrew. You're not saying that you're a Cherokee. You know, I was looking at a Dane Calloway video. And then they had this brother. He said, I'm a Cherokee. I used to own Africans as slaves. See? So if you start, you know, his grandparents. So if you start going into that nationality stuff, All you're going to do is divide. You're going to divide. So our only hope, only salvation, is to be one. And it doesn't take total black unity to get into
right. Being. That's
but
right.
What it has to be a cadre that's very interesting, you know, and making things happen. You know, today, I'm going to do the second part. And I'm going to do my second part in the history of Aboriginals. The only problem is that I ended up having so much that now I got to have a third part too. But I'm not going to do the third part.
Oh, okay.
Until a couple of months down because, you know, our history is so great, you know.
Sure. So excellent. Fantastic.
Did you have anything you wanted to say before I go?
No, that was phenomenal. We're already 44 minutes in. That would be great. Well, one of the things we could talk about, I guess, you know, Kevin Hart, the comedian, is getting a lot of flack because he said the ancient Egyptians were black. And obviously they were. But, you know, I sense that they are trying to attack black people's First Amendment. They're trying to kill off our identity where we can't even talk about it. Remember, My slogan, logo, and motto is nothing's wrong with black people. Something happened to black people. So I own the domain, and I put that domain up on in a description. And Facebook, you know, I think it was not whenever we did that last show, not the last show, but the show before last, as we're filming, like right now, Facebook, I got, we stream to Twitter, YouTube, LinkedIn, and 5 Facebook platforms, which is a total of 8 platforms simultaneously. So that day, they literally, all of the Facebook feeds shut down. What? And I was like, what the hell just happened here? Yeah, while you were doing your presentation and everything, it was like, what's going on? And so I backtracked, found out, oh, nothing. So watch this, family. This is what's happening. The term, nothing's wrong with black people, is a policy violation for Facebook. Can you believe that shit?
Be a policy violation.
Bro, this is how they fight. You have to understand, on my end, I'm the intellectual property guy, right? So I write books, I do webinars, I dominate on YouTube, I put a lot of content out there. But the difference is that they try to label it black identity, Afrocentric, all of that is negative. They're just trying to censor anything where black people do have a sense of unity, right? Because you tell a black person ain't nothing wrong with you, something happened to you, you're going to be the main person in the conversation in the room. All the black people are going to come to you. And so it's wonderful for me in a sense. And I know that sounds oxymoronic, but I love it because it lets me know I'm doing the right thing.
But you know,
I'm on the right path.
I can't understand it because see,
did you get my text? I did a screenshot. You remember?
Yeah, I saw it. But yeah. then they said when you send it to it, it said go to the main page. When I went to the main page, it didn't have nothing there.
Right.
So they're attacking you because the fact is that you have the nerve enough to say that we're not ill. So they're attacking you because you're saying that we're not crazy.
We're not mentally ill. We're not dumb. We're not stupid. We're not slow. We are under a signal interruption that is that mask and looks like that we're sick, but we're not sick. We're sick from being around, captured, corralled, and controlled by sick people.
That's right. That's right. And it can be so, but that's scary.
Isn't that crazy? I just want you to know, because I know you're not necessarily a tech guy per se, but from the intellectual property standpoint and AI and algorithms and how they use those algorithms, certain words, tones, and sounds that if it's black, now if I'm bouncing a ball, if I'm calling you and everybody else the N-word all the time, if I'm calling our sisters bees and hoes and all of that, if I have a show like that, I'd have 100 million subscribers by now. But because this thing is so highly, it breaks through. Nothing's wrong with black people. Something happened to black people. It breaks through the noise of the BS, and that's a threat. You know, we are a threat to that whiteness, if you will, that whiteness behavior.
You know, I think it's not only that, but see, when you say that, what you're telling us is that you know we do have agency. What you're saying is that we do have agency.
Absolutely.
That we're not totally dominated by white supremacy. And I guess they're afraid that you're going to get people to understand that. I wonder they haven't put B1 in that
category. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But that's terrible. That's terrible. Mm-hmm. You know, Reverend Matthews, that is so terrible that you know, that's love. That statement is love.
Absolutely. 100%. 100%. It's got AMA all in it.
but you're not attacking any other racial group.
No, I'm not.
People on gender. All you understand is that is nothing wrong with it. Wow.
Right. Right. Exactly. They don't want that to get out. They don't want black people to know. Check this out. They don't want black people to know ain't nothing wrong with you.
Yeah.
Because something happened to you, and what's happening to you is the people that did the most harm to you. They can't do you the most amount of good or any level of good whatsoever. Yeah. And so, you know, like, Deborah Smith says, we won't be silenced, nor will we bow down. Thank you for that, Deborah. Or is it? It might be Deborah or Deborah. I don't know how you pronounce it, but based upon the spelling. But thank you, Goddess, for that. But yeah, man, you know, like they literally. This is how crazy it is, fam. You know, I do a lecture every Sunday Nothing's wrong with black people. Something happened to black people. There's the web address. Go there now and go there as quickly as you can. I don't know how long it'll be there. But they literally, and this is the first time in the history that I've been working with YouTube since 2007, that they had a copyright issue with my lecture that's coming up on Sunday on the science of memetics. They flagged that and gave it a copyright flag, but the video has not run yet. So how do they flag something that hasn't even been presented, that's not even live on YouTube yet? That's the ish that I go through on the back end, but that's letting me know that the algorithms, and I think all of you out there, you're sending this stuff out, sharing this stuff. The message is coming across, and it can't be denied. It cannot be denied, because I'll always find a workaround. Please.
And I think you said that you own the copyright to that, don't you?
Oh, absolutely, 100%. 100%. Yeah, because I've got two trademarks. I've got one on metaphysical Morpheus, and of course, the four frequencies. Wow. So anything that I think, say, do, or produce is protected under that. But the algorithms don't care.
it's really sad. But all we can do is we had to try to fight the power.
Absolutely. That's what we're doing.
Fight the power.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Shout out Chuck D, Flavor Flav.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Oh, man.
I don't know. I don't like hearing that, because if they're gonna put a simple statement like that, if they're gonna put that in the algorithm as some way to hold us down, I don't know. Wow, that's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's nothing in there that's biased. There's nothing in there that's gender, racial, no bias. Just a statement to be afraid to let people know that you're not sick.
Right, right.
That they're so afraid that if people begin to recognize that is nothing wrong with you, and that you really have a purpose, it's crazy. You know, it's just like I was talking earlier about these black superintendents of schools who don't understand that the kids need to practice before they take a test, and they're satisfied. Mm-hmm. They're making hundreds of thousands of dollars,
mm-hmm.
and they're not teaching our children, but. Well, uh-huh. I don't have any kids. Well, my grand, I don't have, well, my kids all grown, but my grandkids, I'll put it like that, my grandchildren, to see them being, and your children, just being, you know, just being obliterated, teaching them in the schools, they're teaching
that's
them,
the word.
They're teaching them they're mentally ill, they're special education, they're deficit, and then they're afraid of what you're saying.
Yes, yes. That's absolutely. All right, let's get your PowerPoint up. We'll talk about Kevin Hart later.
Okay, part two, origins, Aboriginal foundational Black Americans. As I told you in part one, there formerly existed numerous stone walls, that formerly existed pyramids made of stone. Yes, pyramids made of stone, just like in Mexico. They once existed, but what happened is this. You know, haven't you ever wondered how they built those trains across the United States and they didn't have to bring in stone and dirt? They built those trains, you know, leading from the north to the south, you know, because of the fact that they just tore down our pyramids made by our Aboriginal ancestors. They tore down those stone walls, and they used those pyramids, and they used those stone walls as quarries. See, no way they could have built those railroads. Just think about no way they could have built those railroads.
Absolutely.
Without any stone, without any dirt. But that's what happened to our pyramids. That's what happened to our mounds. But today I'm going to talk a little bit about the mound cultures. I'm going to talk a little bit about Montezuma. Down at the down the bottom, you can see where we talk about Abu Bakari and the influence of Abu Bakari and the Malian people. That doesn't mean that all of our ancestors in North America were members of the Malian expedition, but a lot were. And then you can see that picture right above. We can see some of the artifacts that they found in the mounds. And as I said last week, every Aboriginal, every foundational Black American needs to have a copy of my book in their house. We are not just Africans. They need to have this book because it presents our history as Aboriginals and African people that founded and made FBA. Everybody should have a copy that we are not Africans. Okay, you can go to Patreon to see the slides, and you can go to Twitter at Dr. Clyde Winters 8, and you can go to Clyde Winters YouTube to see my videos and order my books at Amazon.com. This past weekend, we had another session with my Patreon, and I really enjoyed it. And I know somebody suggested to talk about the floods, the great floods. I don't know if I want to talk about that, but I will have something on my Patreon, maybe towards the end of the month, that will be interesting and exciting. So I hope you guys will join my Patreon and join me on my live broadcast when I discuss these issues. Because, see, it's my Patreon that is that allows me to be able, in a sense, to do some of my research. Let me explain to you. It costs money to make copies in libraries. It costs money to buy books. You know, I spend at least, you may not believe this, but I spend at least $300 to $500 every month buying new books. And a lot of these books, I have to buy them so I can write them my PDFs. Or if I'm not writing a PDF, I have to buy these books so I can get information so that I can be able, in a sense, to make these slide presentations. You know, so I hope you'll support my Patreon. Also support Dr. Matthew's Patreon. You know, some of the stuff that you really want to find out about why we're not suffering, that has to be put only in Dr. Matthew's Patreon. Join his Patreon.
And that makes a lot of sense too, Doc, because look at what they're attacking. If they're attacking just the basic aspect, the basic idea that nothing is wrong with Black people, then yeah, you have to use certain platforms to be able to give that information and of how to survive and what we need to do to break through.
Right, but
you're absolutely right.
But what made that hit on you so bad, Reverend Matthews, that they didn't really tell you what was wrong.
No, they didn't.
And so then that means, in a sense, that means that they may want to try to take you off YouTube without any evidence, just because the fact is this is that you dare to want to make Black people FBA, Black people around the world. You see, you're not just in a sense talking about FBA. You're not just talking about FBB, Foundational Black Britons. You're talking about Black people globally.
Absolutely, globally. Worldwide. That's right.
And what's making it so bad is that you're talking to Black people around the world, and you're talking to them in a language that is intellectual. You're talking to them in a language that is founded on research that some Europeans have done.
Social science, my beloved. Absolutely.
Right. And that's scary.
Absolutely. Yeah, it is. Yeah, it is.
Because, see, they want you, family. They want you, family, to believe that this is just ish. They want you to believe that we're just making up stuff. That's why I write the PDFs and I write my books. You see, I do that so that you can have the information. But now when they're trying to attack Reverend Matthews, and all he's doing is saying there's nothing wrong with us.
Exactly. Damn. Right.
Nothing wrong, baby.
Yeah, it's nothing wrong with us. There's something wrong with them. That's for sure. Go ahead, Doc.
We need you. What is FBA? FBA is not a group. FBA is not an organization. FBA is a lineage. A lineage is lineal descent from an ancestor, ancestry or pedigree. As a result, we are descendants of the African and Aboriginal Blacks who built America. Yes, we're descendants of the Aboriginal people who made it. B1, we're B1, Black first. B1 is acknowledging your Black African ancestry and Mod, not heritage. What is B1? B1 is unity with Mod. Dr. Marie Childs has noted that. Kim Dijit in Mod. Kim Dejet in Mott, to be Black, speak you Mott. You know, this is a picture of the Blackfeet. And you know, I know my wife's grandmother, on her father's side was Blackfeet. But do you know now they claim there's no Blackfeet in the South, because the Blackfeet in the South are mainly foundational Black Americans. And so what they do, they're always trying to take things away from us. What you're going to learn is this, is that because of the fact that we're the Aboriginal people in the United States, the European, he created a buffer group. And the first buffer group that he created to try to diminish our influence, that tried to diminish the power of the Black Indians, was that he began, in a sense, to get the Mongoloid Indians. You know, I was the other day, I was looking at that, as I said, I was looking at a video by Dane Holloway, and then his brother, he's going to say, oh, I'm Cherokee. I used to own Africans as slaves. Who give a damn about that? See? But see, that's just to show you what nationalism got us. You know, a lot of people, they want to run back to that nationalism. But what did Neely Fuller said? Neely Fuller said you have to look at history and you have to take from history not just all the good things that you've done, not just all the great effects that you've done, but you have to look at the things that destroyed us and what destroyed us as a people, what took away our land. What took away our land was the fact that as Cha-Cha, as Uche, as Yamasee, as Cree, as Cherokee, they sold each other. They sold each other. The Black Indians sold each other, and then the Mongoloid Indians that we adopted, they started making some of the African slaves. What does that mean? That means that when you only want to express yourself as a nationality, that weakens you. It might be 500 Black Cherokee over there. Maybe there's another 200, you know, the Napi Black Indians. But see, you're dividing yourself, and let's look, we have to always remember that it takes five fingers to make a fist. If you try to hit somebody with just your hand, that's not doing anything. That's not causing any impact. It's your fist that causes impact, because it's through unity, nationalism, being a Moor, being a Hebrew, being a Choctaw, being a Catholic, being a Protestant, being, in a sense, a Lutheran, a Muslim. That doesn't unify us. It just allows, in a sense, second frequency to divide us. You know, if you want to find out about the Blacks in America, you got to go get the work of Dr. David Imhotep. And then we know also, you know, Ivan Van Sertima, and of course me. And see, we're scholars who try to prove that the Olmecs were Black and that Blacks came to America before Europeans. If you want to find out, This I'm going to talk today about some of the Aboriginal history. If you want to find out more information about many of the points that I'm going to discuss today, you know, I want you to get the Black History Gems Essays, Volume 1. And in Volume 1, you're going to find, in a sense, an essay, The Aboriginal FBA in Black History. So you got to go to Black History Gems Volume 1 if you want to find out more. It's important to remember that foundational Black Americans, FBA, are an exceptional people. The FBA people of the United States are descendants of Black Native Americans, and former chattel slaves are the oldest living ethnic group in the history of the United States. This results from the fact that our FBA ancestors have lived in the United States prior to the founding of the USA and writing of the United States Constitution. You got to remember that FBA have always been here. We've always been on this country, on this continent. We've always been in North America. See? We didn't just come here as slaves, but that's what they want to condition you, because see, they want you to just think that, oh, all the FBA, they're African American, and they're African American because their ancestors came from Africa. That is a lie. Many people did come from Africa. But all of our ancestors didn't come from Africa. But see, that's the hijack. Yes, it's a hijack. They want to tell you that all the Black people who are foundational Black Americans, they all came from Africa. Then that way you'll be saying, I'm going back to Africa. No, they took your land.
The United States of America is my Africa. I'm African wherever I was born. Wherever you're born, that's your Africa. That's your Africa.
Not only that this is our country, the fact is this, that they owe us money for land. They want to just talk about all the Black people they made slaves. They took my land. My Choctaw ancestors, they took our land. But how did they take our land? They were very devious. I'll give you an example. The European, you know, he, in a sense, he was at war with the Yamasee. And then the Yamasee, they was kicking their ass. But then the white man say, oh, you Mongoloid Cherokee, you know what? If you kind of come on our side, we'll help you beat the Yamasee and we'll give you their land. Bye-bye. And what did the Mongoloid Cherokee do? They sold out. And when they sold out, then America lost. Then the Yamasee lost. The Yamasee lost because you had the white man and you also had some of the Cherokee attacking them. And then after that, the Cree, they came and then they said, okay, since you fighting the white man, we're going to kick your ass too. And then the Cree attacked the Yamasee too. So they could take a lot of their land in Florida. Yes, 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 yes.
Preach it, Doc. Preach it. Teach it. Preach it.
The white man took over America because our Aboriginal brothers and sisters were fighting each other. And the white man would have us fight each other. Then they'd take us on and take our shit away. Listen. 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 You will not find one treaty. Maybe one up in Massachusetts. But outside of New England, you will not find one treaty that the United States government signed with Black Indians. They didn't sign treaties with us. They just took our damn land and said, get your ass, get out of here, get off my land. See? They didn't want to give any identification. They didn't want to have any documentation saying they owe you ish. Because they know they owe us money. They owe us money not just by being enslaved by them as prisoners of war. We were prisoners of war. And they took our land. They burned our villages. Why? Because we were disunified. Instead of being B1, they were Choctaw, Uchi, Yamasee, Creek, and there's so many damn Indian, there's so many Indian names, you can't even keep up with all the tribes. But that's because of the fact that we love to be nationalists. But we got to stop being nationalists. We got to be B1, Black first.
So, beloved, who was Mansa Abukari?
Mansa Abukari, he was the leader of Malay. I know many of you have heard about Mansa Musa, and Mansa Musa, he was a king of Malay, and they said that he was the richest man in the history of the world, because Mansa Musa had so much gold that he brought down, in a sense, the price of gold all the way throughout the Middle East and Europe. But see, before Mansa Musa, there was Abu Bakari. And Mansa Abu Bakari said, hey, I want to go and I want to go and see what's on the other side of the Atlantic. You got to remember this, Steve. See, you've been taught a lie. You've been taught that African people have always lived in isolation. You've been taught that African people couldn't even swim. They've been telling you now that we couldn't even swim. Hell no, you can't swim. When I was in high school, they taught swimming. Nowadays, they don't teach any swimming in the school. So unless you live near a pool, your kids will not grow up being able to swim. But that's another lie. See, Europeans continually lie. But to get back to Mansa Abu Bakari, he said that he wanted to to see what's on the other side of the Atlantic. So he sent out some ships. And so the ships were picked up by currents, and then one guy came back. And then when this one guy came back, Mansa Abu Bakari, he set up thousands of boats, and he brought 25,000. Let me repeat. He came to the New World with 25,000 followers. And these 25,000 followers, many people believe, look on the left-hand side, you see those papyrus boats. Some people believe that he came in these papyrus boats, but they came in canoes. And these canoes, they built these canoes out of some of the ancient trees that existed in West Africa. Some of these ancient trees were thousands of years old. Once they made these ancient trees, they would get the whole tree, they would haul it out, and they would make it in a canoe, and they were so large. Let me repeat. These ancient trees were so large that they could carry 100 people plus supplies. And so when Abu Bakari, when he came to settle the New World, he brought 25,000 people with him, and they brought their supplies. You know, the Malians spoke many languages. They spoke languages including Akan, Dogon, Bozo, Mandi, etc. There were Malian tribes settled throughout the United States of America. They left many inscriptions in the southwestern part of the United States and in the mounds. The presence of Manding and Four Corners, you know, that's out in Colorado and Arizona, is supported by the appearance of Dogon and Bambara ideograms called petroglyphs on rocks in the Anasazi area. I talked some months ago about the Black people that lived in the Southwest. Moreover, there are several tablets found in Four Corners which have been deciphered that were written in an aspect of the Maninke Bambara. But there were also many tribes in Virginia. For example, one of the tribes in Virginia was called the Monacans, but that's what the white folks called them. They called themselves Manicans. And these Monacans, they relate to the Manicans in Africa. But these were the Monacans in Virginia. The Monacans lived in Virginia in the Roanoke River Valley. They mined copper and grew the three sisters, bean, corn, and squash. Yes, yes. Do you know they have mines in Virginia that people were, in a sense, mining copper that go back hundreds of years? Hundreds of years. It was us. We're the ones who introduced the mining of copper, gold, and silver here. The Europeans, all they did was just come over here and try to take our skills, and then they would copy them and then make money for themselves. But let's get back to the Manican. The Manican tribe belonged to the Iroquois Confederacy. Cameron Wood, a researcher, claims to belong to the Manican tribe. You know, she's a mongoloid person. She claims she's a Manican, but she's not a Manican. The Manicans, they died out in the 1880s. But, you know, again, as I tell you, a lot of times, you know, the Europeans, you know, the government, they'll let anybody who's white or anybody who's a mongoloid, and they say they're an Indian, they say, okay, you're an Indian, and they'll grant it. But really, the Manican, they were the last Manican, they claim, died in the 1880s. So this woman is naturally lying. But, you know, again, white people are always ready to make, you know, anybody be an Indian but us. And so she claims that the Manican language is related to Tutelo. Okay, so what I did on the left-hand side, I can show you how many of the words in the Tutelo or Manican language relate to the Mandis language spoken in Africa today. For example, we got Save Black, and then in Mandi is Safe. A lot of times, you know, as I told you before, like you have Baba, Papa, Fafa. Again, so a lot of times the B and E is B and F is interchangeable. Okay, in Tutelo, the word for good and pure is Api. In Mandi is P. In Tutelo, the name for father is Ati. The name for man in Mandi is Tie. In Tutelo, the word for dead is Te, and in Mandi the word is Te. So again, as you can see, these words. So you can see, in a sense, is that the Mandi language that many of the followers of Abu Bakari, you know, that lived They lived in North America. Yes, yes. Many of the Aboriginal Black Indians, their ancestors were from that voyage in 1310. That doesn't mean it was other Black people who was already here before. Don't get it twisted. I'm not trying to say the only Black people came here in 1310 with Abu Bakari, but I want you to understand is that we do have evidence that some of those people who did come with Abu Bakari, they came to North America, and they were a dominant group. You know, and you'll find in the sense of many of the mounds, you'll find that in the Monacans, they buried their dead in the mounds. And what do we find? We find many of these mounds throughout the United States have these black images in there. And see, artifacts. And that because many of these mounds were built by the Malinke. But, as I told you before, there were mounds being built in the United States thousands of years before the people of Mali came here with Abu Bakari. But this is just to talk about the fact is that there is a great deal of Mandi influence because it was so many of those people that came from Mali in North America. On the other side, on the right-hand side, you can see a tablet that was found in the Gray Creek Mound in West Virginia that showed these signs. The extinct Nanticoke language, you know, there's the Nanticoke Indians. Well, when you study their language, what you find is that the Nanticoke, you know, spoken by Black indigenous tribes along the Potomac River, was a Mandi language too. Yes, yes, yes. The Nanticoke language, we know in a sense, when you look at the numerals that they collected, the first numerals, they were identical to the Mandingo languages. A good example of the Malian influence in the North America are the Nanticokes. The Nanticokes were described by B.S. Barton as very dark. This tribe of Black Native Americans formerly lived in the Chesapeake Bay in Delaware. The Nanticoke have two origin traditions. The first is that formerly they lived in the central United States and migrated around eastward 300 years before the coming of the European to avoid incessant warfare. Due to this warfare, they began to migrate from the central United States to the shores of the Chesapeake. The Powhatans went north, while the Shawnee and Nanticoke went south. Interesting thing about this tradition is that it would place their origin in the central United States around 1300. See? So when you count back 300 years from when the Europeans landed in the Americas, that would go back to 1300. And in 1310, what do we know happened? We know in a sense that Abu Bakari brought a lot of these people here, and a lot of them settled along the Mississippi River. We also know about the Black people who lived out south, lived in the Southwest. So we see that the tradition of the Nanticoke people goes back, interestingly, goes back to the Malians who came with Abu Bakari. The Nanticokes first met the European in 1608. Between 1641 to 1648, they were fighting wars with the colonists and other Indians who wanted their land to sell or to sell them as slaves. As I told you before, the Mongoloid Indians have never been our allies. You got to remember, you see, that FBA has never had any allies. Nobody is our allies. Nobody. Due to the constant wars with the European colonists, the Nanticoke affiliated with the Iroquois by 1753. Although the Nanticoke had fought many wars against the Iroquois, they got along better with this group than the colonists. By 1765, some Nanticoke migrated up to Ontario and had become part of the Iroquois Confederation. Look over there on the left-hand side. On the left-hand side, you can see the numbers. You can see the numbers from 1 to 10. And these numbers were collected by Peralius. And as you see, number one, Kille, that was the same as in the Mandingo language of Muller. Muller was a guy who studied the Mandingo back in the 1700s. But anyway, we can see number one, Kille, for Nanticoke. Then we see Killen in the Mandingo language. For number two, we see Fille. And then in the Mandingo language, we see Fula. For number three, we see Sapo. And in the Mandingo language, we see Saba. Remember how we talked about the Manichan language, and how the Manichan language, we saw an F and a P, F and a B, P. Now we can see how we see a P and a B. As I told you before, in many languages, there's always, in a sense, there's a change between the B, the F, the B to F, and the P. For example, sometimes people call you Baba, father. Then in other places, instead of Baba, we have Papa, which means father. In some places, we have Fafa, for father. So again, as I show you, so that's very interesting, that just as in the case of the Manichan, we find that the Nanako, they talked about their P, but sometimes wasn't originally a B. For number four, we have Nano, and then in the Mandingo is Nani. So you can look at these words from 1 to 10, and you see how the Nanticoke Indians had the same number system as the Mandi people. And the Mandi people were part of what? The Malay Empire. In 1528, the Spanish explorer Cabeza de Vaca and Estevanico de Moore, you know, the black guy from Azamor, discovered numerous people living in the American Southwest. As they sought to discover the seven cities of Cibola, the seven cities of Cibola were supposed to be centers where fantastic amounts of gold could be found. In the Four Corners region, de Vaca found various ethnic groups speaking a multiplicity of languages. Due to the pluralistic nature of these societies, the people could only communicate using sign language. Saram noted that, and I quote, "In reality, the inhabitants of the Pueblos, as we now know, were members of extraordinarily varied tribes. They spoke widely different languages and had different historical backgrounds." This is very important. Today, they only talk about the Zuni Indians and the Navajo Indians. They're not, the Zuni, Navajo, and Hopi. They weren't the only ones there. There were black Indians there too. Yes, 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 yes. Study, learn our history. De Vaca said that one of these ethnic groups was named Mandinka. Mandinka, Mandingo, Mandinga. Do you see? This name is almost identical to the word Mandinka, Malinke, the name of one of the Mandingo-speaking people. And if you go into West Africa, you're going to find these so-called, look at this picture. You're going to find the so-called Kangaba signs. And that's a Kangaba sign with a circle, a straight line, and then we see, you know, hands, and we see feet. But when you go in a sense into the American Southwest, you find the Gujra signs. And the Gujra signs, as you can see on the right-hand side, they're identical to the Kangaba sign. And then throughout much of the Southwest, you're going to find the habitation sign. And the habitation sign, as you can see, it's almost a circular sign, but it also seems as though it looks like a foot. But as you can see, this is a sign of habitation. See, stop it. Stop. Know your history. When you hear people like Dane Calloway, and you hear people like, in a sense, you know, Caremio, and they tell you that stop believing that you're African. Yes, you do have some African ancestors. You had tribe-like tribes called the Mandinka, the Manichans, the Nanticoke. Who spoke an African language? Stop! These people weren't slaves, but they were here. Stop letting Dane Calloway and Caremio make you feel, in a sense, that we don't have any African ancestry. We do. We do. But Dane Calloway and Caremio, they don't do any research. They just follow the white man. And listen, if you notice, Dane Calloway, he has over almost 400,000 subscribers. Caremio has 100,000 subscribers. They take away subscribers from Reverend Matthews, but do you know why Dane Calloway has so many subscribers? Do you know why Caremio has so many subscribers? because they're teaching us to be disunified. They're teaching us not to identify as Black.
Wow, that's fascinating.
They support them.
That's fascinating, Doc.
It is. You know for a fact that you should have more than 60,000 subscribers.
Sure.
You know that. Because too many people look at it. But they promote them because they are divide and rule. They don't want you to understand you're B1. B1! Put B1 in the chat, baby. In the Anastasiary, we find many depictions of Malinke Bambara habitation signs and the Kangaba sign in the American Southwest. This sign is frequently found in West Africa, in areas settled by Mandi-speaking people. The Kangaba sign is clearly depicted among the various mountains of southern Arizona. Look. Here we see the Mesa Verde. That's on the left-hand side. Then we see in Mali where the Dogon live. Yes, the Dogon. And it better not be nobody that's nobody in the family that don't know about the Dogon. But you can see how the Dogon built the same types of structures. The people who built the cliff dwellings of Mesa Verde and the great houses of Chaco Canyon were subsistence farmers of corn, beans, and squash, the three sisters. They match exactly the Mali cliff dwellings. I don't have to lie to you. But when Dane Calloway and Caremio, when they tell you that you're not Black, when they're telling you that you're not African, they want you to go back. They want you to go back to the way it was when the white man first got here. And that's how the white man took over the country. That's how the white man took our land, because we was Choctaw, Yoruba, Creek, Yuchi, every damn body but Black. That's why they called the Indians copper colored. And that's why today you see mongoloid and white people going around saying that they're the Cree. You see mongoloid and white people going around saying that they're the damn Choctaw. You see mongoloid and white people going around saying that they're the Blackfeet. That's a lie. Because the Blackfeet are you. The Choctaw are you. Me. Us. Stop. Know your history. Here you see in the Southwest, look how they built their houses. Look how they built the houses in the Southwest. They put up there in a sense the mud. Then they had in a sense the logs coming out of it. But whoa. Look at Mali. Mali, they built the same type of houses. And then in Timbuktu, look at those structures. Look at the houses. We still see the mud dwellings. We still see the sticks. Stop.
Is it time for your pills, Doc? Is it time for you to take your pills?
I think so. I might take a nappy now. But
love it, man. This is insane. But this is the, you know, they say a photograph is worth 1,000 words or whatever. This is insane, man.
And see, and this goes back to what?
Look at the continuity. There's just continuity. It has to be us.
That's right. But we had to remember what Professor Dr. Childs has taught us, Marie Childs. This is first sight consciousness.
Yes, Ashe. Continuity. Yes.
You said the right word. It's the continuity. Yep. We carried this over from Africa to here. But then you got Dane Calloway. And you got Caremio telling you, don't you believe. You're not Black. You're not African. You're Cherokee. And, oh, yeah. You're this. You're that. Yeah, that's how the white man took our shit. That's how we became prisoners of war. Even though this was our
Preach it and teach it. That's right. That's how we got in this mess in the first place.
And they took our land because we were talking about nationalities instead of being unified. I ain't going to be no Cherokee. I ain't going to be no damn. I ain't going to be no huge. I ain't no damn Choctaw. The elegant slab discovered in 1910 in the Native American ruins by Boy in Flor Vista, New Mexico. Here's the elephant slab. I translated this years ago, but this is what it reads, and I quote, the desert is hot. Birds are numerous. White, just as the go, police bird in our language. The elephants are sick and angry. At present, the sick elephants are considerable. Life is spent removing thou sick elephants dried up by the sun. Many are sick. The dead elephants are pushed down into a hole, buried and sealed on the flat terrain adjoining the bed of the river at the dry place, the zone of inundation. My existence at the present family habitation is lean. On dry land adjoining the bed of the river, break up the terrain for cultivation and thou cut the help. Break to pieces the flatlands to carve and make family habitations, warmth, water, sun. Damn, yes. What this shows is that when the people from Mali, when they came over here with Abu Bakr, they brought elephants with them. Yes, they found mastodon bones. But a mastodon, they were built different from elephants. And the African elephant is different from the Indian elephant. And they found elephants. Yes, they found elephants. But I told you, the Malians, they made canoes so big that the canoe, if a canoe could carry 80 to 100 people, you know it could have carried an elephant too. And they brought elephants and they found elephants. Yes. Yes. In the second volume of my podcast, I discuss in a sense the Indian slab, and I show you the footnotes. I show you where the elephants were found. You gotta get that podcast if you want to find out more about these elephants. The Mandy have left us the following greeting. You see a lot of people today. Hello, Niji, 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 Niji. And you know, I see the people on Dan Calloway's show. They're always saying Niji. And they so dumb. They're so dumb. They think that the Mongoloid Indians made that greeting up. No. Niji is a Mandi word. It comes from the word ni, which means the manifestation of life. Ni means friend. Ji means male virile. So in other words, it was a greeting among the male Indians. When they would meet each other, they would say Niji. That's like saying, how you doing, friend? You see? And yet, These dumb people following Dane Calloway and Karimio, they don't even know that Karimio and Dane Calloway is telling them that they're not African, telling them that they're not black, and yet they're using the Mandi word, Niji. And that's because of the fact that many of the people in the first Iroquois, there was two Iroquois confederations. When they talk about the Iroquois, that's not a tribe. The Iroquois was a confederation. And the first Iroquois confederation was not up around New York and Massachusetts and all that. The first Iroquois, you know, confederation was in Virginia, where there was a lot of Mandi speaking people. And that's how they got the greeting, Niji. What up, though? What up, though? The other day, I was talking to this lady, and she was saying, So then, you know, black people always say, what's up? And so she said that Francis Welsing said that what up is because black people don't understand where they're coming from. But mm-hmm. I explained to her, no. I said, what up is a greeting that black people say. And the following greeting after that is, how you doing?
Mm-hmm.
And then I explained to her that in Swahili, we have habari gani. And habari gani in Swahili means, what's the news? See, in other words, it's a black Aboriginal African tradition. A first asking you how you doing, and then you can say, "Oh, if your old brother like me, say, oh, my bones hurt, my knee hurt." But anyway,
back in the day when I was coming up in Chicago, we used to say, "Yo, yo, what up, though?" And the dough, it was D-O. It was like, "What up, though?" You know, and that was our colloquialism. And in a very real sense, Doc, it was kind of our own lingua franca, if you will.
Yeah, it was. And just like today, everything we make up the second frequency, got to take it. They got to take the knuckle bump.
Yep, fist pump and all of that.
And then when people like when on the radio and the DJs would say, you know, when the DJs would make a mistake and say something, say my bad. Now the second frequency got to say my bad. They are just so imitative.
Yep.
They're so imitative. That's why so many people do not understand that American culture is FBA culture, because everything we do, they want to copy it.
That's right. That's a fact.
And it's just like Dane Calloway. When Dane Calloway, he thought he had found something new. Oh, Niji. That's African too. Nigga, what? Nigga, what? You can't run away from your black.
That's another colloquialism of that we do. That's all. Oh man. So who was the Malinke? And why is it important, brother, for us in the history of to know about this history of the Aztecs?
That's a good point. We know that the Aztecs were Malinke or Mandi people because of the Spanish Aztec interpreter name Malinke. And this is just a picture of they share. They got I forgot what you call those things that a wood cutting of her leading the Spanish. It appears that the Aztecs belonged to the Malinke Bambara tribe. Cortez was given a female translator. This translator was called La Malinke. Alonso Mutukama said she was a Mexica woman. Remember, Mexica. The Aztecs were Mandi speakers. They may be descendants of the followers of Mas Abubakari when he left the Mali Empire to colonize much of the Americas. There is considerable evidence presented by Horace Butler. Horace Butler wrote a book called When Rocks Cry Out. And in it, he showed that the Aztecs were Muslims from Mali. Yes, Muslim Mali. A lot of people don't know that they really wanted to destroy the Aztecs, because the Aztecs, who really, their name was not Aztec. That's what the local people called them. Their name was Mexica, see? And the Spanish and the people hated them. The other Indians hated them, but they would use a lingua franca or a trade language called Nahuatl. Nahuatl, that's a trade language, but it was a trade language invented by the Mexica. The name Malinke translates Malinke. The fact that La Malinke translates as Malinke means that the Aztecs identified themselves as Malinke. Here's a picture. Here they got a. Here in this picture, this is the woodcut I was talking about. You can see in the front, they got Malinke. She's in the front. You can see her hairstyle, braids. Then behind them come the Spanish, and then some of the Indians who came. Because see, the Indians, they were happy. They were very happy to fight with the Spanish, because they hated the black people too. As I tell you, we have no allies. Those local Indians, they thought they were being smart by joining the Spanish to destroy the Mexica Empire. But all they did was they took the Mexica Empire and took their stuff too. The Mongoloid Indians are always betraying us. The Mongoloid Indians are always turning on us. And yet every time they turn on us, it doesn't help them, because they need us. They need us. The Aztecs said they were Mexica. The name shows that the Aztecs were Mandinka. It's interesting to note that many Quiche, remember Quiche, that's one of the Maya tribes. We use the term Maya to identify the Mayan people, but there's no such people as Maya. The Maya, in a sense, is a term that the white folks made up to call the Quiche tribe and other tribes that spoke a similar language. It is interesting to note that many Quiche words beginning with X, which is pronounced sh, correspond to words borrowed from Malinke Bambara with an initial S, e.g. shab, rain. It shab, rain, goes along with sa. Isha, seed, goes along with si. Ushi, root, goes along with sulu or suru. Often we find the Mandi words with S appear as C, X or K in the Mayan languages. For example, Maliki Bambara, the word means, sa means to sell, to buy in the market. This is related to the Mayan word con, to sell, and con, serpent. In Quechua, we have kax, kax, sky, which correspond to mandi, sa, ka, sky. In Quechua, many words beginning with the cha correspond to words they borrowed from the Maliki Bambara language. So again, like I said, that we know in a sense that the Maliki Bambara had a great influence, but a lot of things we don't know. And then we know in a sense that Mandy C, in Delafaux's Maliki Bambara dictionary, C, the collective meaning, it means family, race, descendants, and also black, you see. Therefore, Mexica, the name of the Aztecs, what does it mean? Ma means master, lord, or owner. She means black, family, race, or descendant. Kind, type, race. So, Mexica, and Ka means what? Nationality or land. So, the word Mexica, which is the real name of the Aztecs, Mexica means lord of the black lands, or masters of the of this race's land. See what I'm talking about? See? Study your history. Don't just take everything you read and the European says. You see? I'm breaking it down. I'm trying to give you, in a sense, the patterns. I'm trying to give you, in a sense, the receipts. I don't make up ish. The Aztecs were not native to Mexico. Montezuma told Cortez, and I quote, "We have known for a long time from the chronicles of our forefathers that neither I nor those who inhabit this country are descendants from the Aborigines of it." Okay. "But from strangers who came to it from very distant parts. And we also hold that our race was brought to these parts by a lord, whose vassals they all were, and who returned to his native country. After a long time, he came back." And then when you read the story of Abu Bakari, you'll find in the sense that he mentions a fact that he sent people to find a new land, and they came back, and then he came. "After a long time, he came back. But it was so long that those who remained here were married with the native women of the country and had many descendants and had built towns where they were living. When therefore he wished to take them away with him, they would not go, nor still less receive him as their ruler. So he departed." There's a picture over there that some of the early Europeans, you know, tried to say Montezuma may have looked like. But again, Montezuma, he was that great king. That's what he told Cortez. He admitted that they came from another land. Stop, 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 stop. Stop listening to Dane Calloway. Especially Dane Calloway. He don't ever show any evidence. All he says is, "You're not black. You're not African. Harriet Tubman didn't exist. Nat Turner, he was just made up. Get out of here."
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Back up. Hold on. What did he say about Nat Turner and Harriet Tubman?
That they didn't really exist. They were made up by the European to deceive us.
What?
Yes. And he's got over 400,000 subscribers.
Well, I need to come on here and just start saying stupid shit then. I mean, just what? What? Yeah. Wow.
You better not. That's better not.
I'm not. I'm like, yeah. Yeah, we're going to be doing a whole series on why Harriet Tubman was alive. What? You won't hear that here.
He wrote a whole book, him and his wife, saying that they were just the white
poor man. Things. Poor things.
It is sad, but
bless them and love them. We're all at various different observations and levels of consciousness. Nothing's wrong with them. Something happened to them, just as well as all of us. But we need to be able to decipher the code between a second, third, fourth frequency and first sight, first frequency sight and first sight consciousness. We have to be able to have that ability.
And see, what is a rule? I'm gonna tell you the rule. What is the rule? Anytime you see white people playing up a black person, and that black person isn't dead, they usually have an alternative reason.
Absolutely, 100%.
See, you know,
100%. Oh my God, that's so true.
Martin Luther King, he was a radical. Martin Luther King said that he was afraid. I forgot the exact quote. Maybe you remember that we were in a burning church or something.
Yeah. I think I've led my family to a burning house.
Yeah.
Something to that effect.
You know, and we know Malcolm
led X. Led my people into a burning house. Yeah.
Right. And, you know, Malcolm X, he was super about black people. He said that we didn't land in Plymouth Rock
ran it on us. That's right.
Landed on us. And yet now they say, oh, they were okay, but they don't teach you their whole history. So when you got a person like Dan Calloway teaching you all these things to keep us divided, that's all. That's his purpose. His purpose is to keep us divided. His purpose is to keep us without. See, his purpose is to keep us from being B1. B1, because they know that if you're B1, if you're black first, you're dangerous. If you're black first, you believe in yourself. If you're black first, you have confidence. If you're black first, you want to see the whole nation. You're not afraid of any other black person. You want to see all black people rise as you rise. But when you got a brother talking about, oh, get your nationality, speak your nationality, learn your history. That's how we lost America. We lost America being so nationalistic. We were so nationalistic that now the white man tried to erase our history. And he has erased the history of the black man and gave it to the Mongoloid Indians. The Aztec elites, you know, look here. Here we see an Aztec elite, you see. You know, and we see that the Aztecs, they wore many other stuff. Here's an Aztec elite on the left. And on the right, we see a Brazilian elite. If you notice, they both wore those shorts. Look how they wore those shorts, those knee shorts. This was a military dress. This was the dress of a Malian Marine. Oh, yes. African nations had Marines and Army. They didn't. Well, the Egyptians had Air Force, but we won't go there.
All right, Doc. Now, what was the mound culture? What was that about?
Well, the mound culture, the Soto and his men discussed the mounds. They found them on the Florida Indians. Here, as mentioned earlier, lived some African black people. The Soto noted that the Uchida, that at Uchida, Florida, and I quote, the town was of 7 or 8 houses built of timber and covered with palm leaves. The chief's house stood near the beach upon a very high mound made by hand for defense. At the other end of the town was a temple. It's interesting to note that in Florida, one of the major ethnic groups living there was the Yamasee or Jamasee people, which were described as blacks. Yes. Listen, a lot of these black Indians today, because of the fact they don't know their history, you see them around teepees and hitting drums. What did it tell you? The black people, they built towns made of timber. They built log cabins, you dummies. You dancing around a damn teepee. Teepee's not in our tradition. Teepee's for people who migrate. Teepees are for nomads. That's why you carry your house with you. We didn't move around the damn country. The Aboriginal FBA, we built houses of timber and stone. Stop it. My Aboriginal brothers and sisters, stop. Stop believing a lie. The mounds in the United States are usually found near rivers. In the Ohio Valley, 10,000 mounds have been discovered. In the north, the mound zone begins in western New York and extends along the southern shore of Lake Erie into what is now Michigan, Wisconsin, and onto the states of Iowa and Nebraska. In the southern United States, the mounds lie in the Gulf of Mexico from Florida to eastern Texas and extended up through the Carolinas and across to the state of Oklahoma. Yes, that was your people building those mounds. That was your people building those beautiful mounds, not only to bury your kings and leaders in, but also in the sense mounds to protect us from flooded areas and areas in a sense that have you know, floods and stuff. They found in a sense that many places today where Europeans have built houses are not really right. And our people knew that. And now you see the floods come and sweep them away. You see the hurricanes destroy the houses that Europeans built in Florida. But Black people lived in Florida for thousands of years. But their timber houses, they didn't fall. Because they understood the environment. They understood the ecology. Second frequency, they don't deal with nature. They don't deal with Amma. I was reading this lady, I was hearing this white lady the other day. I can't feel spiritual. I can't understand why I can't feel God. I'll tell you why. Because you want to fight God. We don't fight Amma. We don't fight God, and God allows us to use wisdom and knowledge and make things great.
That's right.
FBA have a great history in America. Whites hate it. They want us to only talk about Africa. In my book, I wrote a book called The Black Mound Builders of America. Over on the left-hand side, you can see some of the artifacts found in the mounds. They teach you, you can go to YouTube and you look up mounds, they're going to show you some damn Mongoloid Indians or some white Indians and tell you they built the mounds. These pictures on the left is what they found inside the mounds. They don't look Mongoloid to me, and they definitely don't look like they're second frequency. Stop, 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 stop. FBA technological advancement is thousands of years old. Whites destroyed most of it by using the stone we use to build our monuments, to build their own dwellings, railroad tracks, stations, and roads. Much of the FBA history goes back to the Malian influence among the mound builders. This corresponds to the artifacts recovered from the Southern Death Cult, the pipes recovered from many mounds in the United States, and the name for tobacco suggested it was the Mandi who introduced tobacco to the New World. Yes, the Indian word for tobacco is the Mandingo word. The Mandi may have also constructed the temple mounds. These mounds were built between AD 700 and 1700 AD. The temple mounds were built in the central Mississippi Valley, Arkansas, southern Missouri, southern Illinois, and western Tennessee. DeSoto and his men discussed the mounds they found among the Florida Indians. Here is mentioned earlier, there's some African Black people. DeSoto noted that at Uceda, Florida, and I talked about the town, how they built, in a sense, a temple, you see? And here's some of the Yamasi. And if you notice the Yamasi, they had what? They had wraps. You know, Black people really love to have those wraps around their head, look like a kufi hat, you see? And then they also had turbans. And then some people just wore, you know. But if you notice anywhere those headdresses, you see a lot of these Black Indians today, you know, they don't know shit about their history. Because they don't know shit about their history, they try to imitate whatever the Mongoloid Indians do. They get a little drum, my ass. And then they go out.
You are so... I'm sorry. That's just so wrong on so many levels, but it's hilarious. I love it.
Okay. Didn't build no DPs. Get out of
here.
Oh,
man. Oh, that was great. That was fantastic.
The mounds in the United States are usually found near rivers. In the Ohio Valley, 10,000 mounds have been discovered, you see. And these mounds, in a sense, are just always so expansive. Look at this map. If you look at this map on the right-hand side, you can see, you know, a path that connected mounds. You know, people, Carimio, like I said, Carimio is a bibliophile, and I like a lot of the books that Carimio discusses. But Carimio, he's talking about the roads that existed that connected the Maya towns, you know, he should be talking about the roads that connected our towns. Our mounds. Many of the mounds were connected by roads. We built roads too. Some of them were lined with stone. But Carimio don't talk about that. because he only talks about what he only talks about what he might happen to read in a book. But if he did research, he could find out more. The mounds of ancient America followed the lines of the Mississippi and Ohio River and outlying regions as well. They vary in size from colossal mounds in Illinois to mere blisters rising from the earth. You know, a truck driver once wrote me an email. He said, Dr. Clyde, you know, you are so right. He said, because he said he drives throughout the United States, and he found many mounds across the United States with fence around them that say no trespassing. Yeah, they say no trespassing, because in those mounds, they're afraid if you dig in them, you're going to bring out some more pictures of Negroes, some more pictures of Blacks. If you keep on bringing all these artifacts from these mounds of Blacks, then somebody might start to believe the truth that the Blacks were here first. Most if not all of these mounds had long been abandoned by their former inhabitants when they were discovered by the Europeans. Many excavated mounds have yielded human bones, weapons, tools, inscriptions, and jewelry. Researchers discovered that at Cahokia, there were tunnels under the mounds. Listen to this. At Cahokia, there were tunnels under the mounds that went under the Mississippi River to connect Cahokia with mounds on the other side of the river. You didn't know that, did you? There was a tunnel that led from Cahokia under the Mississippi River to the mounds on the other side of the river. Think about this. Do you know the technological and engineering skills those brothers must have had to be able to build a tunnel under the Mississippi River that wouldn't have flooded?
Yep.
And yet they tell you, family, that your kids can't learn shit. They tell you, family, your kids can't even pass a damn test. If they was taught right, they could pass it. How? How? How can they tell you your kids are dumb when our Aboriginal ancestors could build tunnels under the damn Mississippi River? FBA, Foundational Black Americans, you're an exceptional people. You're an exceptional people. They know it.
We are, absolutely.
But they don't want you to know your history. Mound culture. The mounds in the United States may have been built by Africans for defensive purposes while they tried to coexist with local Amerindian populations that lived nearby. This hypothesis is supported by the fact that the Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, Missouri mound sites are located on hilltops overlooking valleys and are clearly defensive works covering many acres with formidable walls of earth, sometimes reinforced by stone. Yes, stone. Didn't they find the mounds in Guatemala, the mounds, you know, in Honduras, the mounds in Belize? The pyramids. They found those pyramids usually under what? Under mounds. And right here it tells you that they found mounds that had pyramids up under them, but they tore that shit up because they didn't like what they found in the mounds. On the right-hand side, you can see some of the mounds that you can see how they built the mounds in Africa, and you can see how they built the mounds in the in West Africa, and you can see how they built the mounds in the Southwest. See, we have the Great Creek mound that I talked about earlier that I showed the originally that had the inscriptions in it. FBA, Aboriginals, we are unique people. The defensive style mound found in the United States had lines of embankments, which averaged between 5 to 30 feet high, with enclosures hundreds of acres wide. Leading out from many of these enclosures, there often were parallel walls, many miles long, forming great avenues. Viner felt that these mounds resembled the African cities of Luanda in the Congo and the ancient city of Benin. W.B. Du Bois also noted, and I quote, on the other side, look on that right-hand side. I want you to look at that. Take a minute. This is how our cities look. Do you see any teepees?
All right, now it's time for your pills. Now it's time for your pills.
But that's how our cities look. We didn't have no TVs. Every time you see Dane Calloway, every time you see Dane Calloway and Carimio going around the damn teepee, this lets you know they don't know ish about our history as Aboriginals. We didn't live in TPs. We built forts. We built houses of wood and stone. The European learned how to build forts from you. He learned how to build forts from me. He learned how to build forts from us. Stop it, Aboriginals. Stop listening to these dumbass people who want to just divide us. Be one. But Du Bois noted, the mounds of the mound builders were probably replicas of Negro forts in Africa, that this tendency to build forts and stockades proceeded from the Antilles, whence the Arawaks had come in the beginning of the 16th century, is proved by the presence of similar works in Cuba. These are found in the most abandoned and least explored parts of the island, and there can be little doubt that they were locations of fugitive Negro and Indian stockades, precisely such as were used in Africa. Yes. These were the same cities that the Black Maroons built, you know, in the dismal swamp. These are the type of cities we build. Stop. Please stop believing you lived in a teepee. Stop dancing around saying, stop it. You built towns. You built cities. You didn't travel around with teepees. You built a house because you stayed in one place. Nigga, what? These are some of the mound artifacts. These are some of the artifacts they found. They dig up the mounds. They didn't really study the mounds back in the day. They didn't really want to do a lot of work because they didn't want you to know who you were. They didn't want everybody to know what Black people did. Here's an artifact found in a mound. Look. He looked like my cousin Fred. Or is that Bill? The most famous mound builders belong to the Mississippians. The Mississippian bound culture dates between AD 750 and 1500. These people built mounds along the Mississippi River and the tributaries from the Gulf of Mexico and Arkansas, Ohio, Missouri, Texas, and Minnesota. The most famous mound site are the Moundville in Alabama and Cahokia in Illinois and the Spiro Mound in Oklahoma. This is how they envision how it must have looked at Cahokia. You see? You, us, me, we built pyramids over here. The reason that we were able to build pyramids, stone pyramids, and mounds is because of what Dr. Marie Chow said, the first sight consciousness is in you, baby. Can you imagine if they didn't keep our kids, if they weren't purposely not teaching our kids, America would have had been really advanced. If you notice, America stopped advancing during the Black Power period. Why? Because during the Black Power period, Europeans, in a sense, were afraid that we was going to know and remember that we were the majority in this country. So they had to bring crack here. They had to start having rap music about Black people, killing each other. Rap music about Black people denigrating our women, thinking about our women as hoes and bitches. Think about how women, all you want your woman to do is they have oral sex on you. Why, dummies? The white man wants you to do that because oral sex don't produce babies. That's not how you procreate. In 1860 was 4,000 Latinos here. 4,000 Latinos were here. Now it's lots of Latinos, but even the majority of Latinos here, they mainly show you all these Mexicans. Most of the Latinos here are Dominicans. And other black people from the Caribbean, but they don't think they're black. They think they're Spanish. So habla español. No sabe español, señor. Una sema Kiswahili. Tunase Kiswahili. Arigani! Arigani! Cahokia Mound between 950 and 1350. These are some of the artifacts from the Cahokia Mound. Where's the white Indian? Where's the Mongoloid Indian? These were the largest mounds found in the Americas, and these are the artifacts they found in here. But they want you to find these artifacts. They want you to see these artifacts and then imagine that they're white Indians or Mongoloid Indians. Nigga, what? Seeing is believing. Here's some more artifacts from the mounds. That's what they found in the mounds. But they tell you you wasn't here. They tell you that you didn't make nothing in this country. They say you African-American. Because they don't want you to know. Because they took your land from you. Look. FBA, be proud of your history. There's cultural continuity. Look, let's look at this. In West Africa, they found in the mound the djinn. They found this figure in the mound. Look at where his hands are on his knee. In that area, they speak the Maliki Mandingo language. And then wait a minute. In the middle, we have an Olmec. How's he sitting? He's not sitting cross-legged. He's sitting with his knees, and his hands are on his knees. And the Olmec, they did what? They spoke a Mandingo language. And then look, the mound builders that they found out in the mounds. Look at that last figure on the far right. This figure was found in the mounds, and where's his hands? They're on their knees, on his knees. Africa, the Olmec in Mexico, the mound builders in North America. First sight consciousness. Don't let Caremio, don't let Dane Calloway tell you that you're not black or African. Yes, be proud. Be proud of your nationality. Be proud of being a Uche, a Cree, a Blackfoot, a Cherokee, Choctaw. Be proud of that. But don't let your nationalism, don't let your nationality blind you to the fact that we're one people. We can't go backwards. We can't go back to those nationalities. That's how the white man took our land. That's how the white man took our money. That's why the white man owes us money. Stop.
I'm gonna put this up on the screen. Thank you, Katrina Prater. She says, tell the truth, shame the white guy. I like that.
Shame the truth.
Tell the truth, shame the white guy. Go ahead on, Katrina.
Shame the white guy. Gotta tell the truth, baby.
Gotta tell the truth, baby.
The Malian Marine uniform. The art from the American mound builders in Brazil indicates the presence of Malian military personnel. Richard Hall and Munya Kaye, African Civilization Before the Bature, that's the name of the book. He noted that, and I quote, the Mali Marines wore white caps on their heads and a white tunic. On the sides of skull caps worn by the Malian Marines. E. Murphy, History of African Civilization, said the uniform of the Malian Marine consisted of sandals, loose-fitting cotton breeches reaching down to the knees, a sleeveless tunic and a white headdress of either cotton or leather, decorated with one of various signs. Look, look, look at this figure from Brazil. Look at this figure from the Spiro Mound. Don't you see those bridges? The bridges down to the knees. I ain't got a lot of you. Stop thinking that only America had Marines and the British. African nations had Marines too. Had army and navies. But the white man, he had taught you that all you were was a slave. He had taught you that you wasn't even an Indian. All you did was come here as a slave. We were not just slaves. We built this country. We built the civilization here. We were engineers. We were scientists. We were doctors. But Second Frequency took our knowledge. They took our lands, and they took our histories, and they gave our histories to the Mongoloid and white Indians. Stop it. Writing has always been a part of the cultural resource of Black and African people. The Anu left many ancient inscriptions in North America. The Malian explorers, here's some of the inscriptions that the Malian explorers left. Look over here. On the left-hand side, I show you a figure from a mound in America. You see that knee is up and that hand is on the top of the knee. But we also find in the West African mounds, we find the same similar figures, because that's what first sight consciousness. First sight consciousness. Marie Chausen taught you. Much of what we do goes back to our African heritage, because that's where we came from first. I talked to you in part one. I talked to you about the fact that Black people came from Africa to North America 130,000 years ago. Stop, stop, stop. Study, know your history. Here's some more inscriptions. There's a list of how you can read some of the inscriptions and that the Mandy left. Look over here. You see the top on the right hand side. We see Spruce Mound inscriptions. We see inscriptions from South America, North America. And look at the Spiral Mound. Look at the Spiral Mound. This is from Spiral Mound on the bottom left hand side. They always try to tell you that all Black people do is talk ish. That may be true, baby. But we always had writing. We always had our own writing systems. We always had left inscriptions. We always wanted to tell our people we read, we didn't just talk ish. In addition to writing at Rockwell, they are writing at the Tongue Creek Petroglyph site, located approximately 70 miles due west of Waco and immediately north of the town of Crawford, McKean County, Texas. See, look at these inscriptions, these other inscriptions. These inscriptions are similar to inscriptions found in Africa. Yet Dane Calloway and Carimio tell you that you're not Black. They tell you you're not African. Stop, 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 stop. I repeat. FBA people have an African ancestry. But our heritage can be Uchi, Blackfeet, Muslim, Moor, Hebrew, Catholic, Black Jew. That doesn't take away the fact that our ancestry is African, and this ancestry of African, even though we may belong to various nationalities, Moor, Hebrew, Catholic, Muslim, because of our African ancestry, we're still B1. That's why we call ourselves foundational Black Americans. We call ourselves foundational Black Americans because we're made up of many different Black folk. Uchi, Cree, Cherokee, Choctaw, Moor, Muslim, Christian, Catholic, but we black first. Be one, be one, be one. Here's some more signs that some more inscriptions that they have found down in Texas and other parts of the country. Look at there. These are all signs that you find in Africa too. I don't have to lie. I don't have to give you no bullshit. The copper culture. The chief artifact or product of the old copper culture was, of course, the metal copper. A vast number of copper tools suddenly appear in the archaeological record without any antecedent. Ronald J. Mason remarks, and I quote, "Incredible number of copper artifacts, tens of thousands in eastern Wisconsin alone, attest to the use of the metal that is at variance with the historical and ethnographic descriptions of Indian life." Yes, yes, yes. No, they didn't find no. Come on now. You know why he wrote that? I'll repeat. Tens of thousands in western and eastern Wisconsin alone attest to the use of the metal that is at variance with historical and ethnographic description of Indian life. We know the mannequins, they had copper. No, you ain't gonna find no damn copper tubes among the damn mongoloids. They got a damn rock, scratch that damn rock, make it sharp, make an arrow. We were farmers. We were growing the Three Sisters, beans, squash, and corn. We made copper tools. Those mongoloids, of course you didn't find no tools with the mongoloids. They didn't want the copper. Get out of here. Know your history. The amount of copper mined from these areas is mind-boggling. An estimated 500,000 pounds. I repeat, 500,000 pounds of copper. Since only a very small amount of this total can be accounted for in the New World archaeological sites, where did the rest of it go? It had to go to the old world, the field of the growing chalcolithic economies of Africa and the Mediterranean civilization. Not a ton of bullshit. See, let me explain to you. The white man, he's always been interested in gold. They felt that gold is the most precious metal. But among black people, among Africans, they didn't feel that gold was the most precious metal. They felt the most precious metal was copper. Because they felt that copper was very malleable and that copper could be used to make the tools to farm with, the tools to hunt with, the tools, in a sense, to make jewelry. Now, you know, tell me a sister that don't like to see some damn jewelry, baby, baby. Got to go buy your lady some jewelry. So we like copper. Mongoloid Indians, no, you were not going to find copper. They were stone. They was mongoloid people. They were nomadic. They had a teepee. And they went around the campfire. Yo, my yoshi,
da, yo. All right, he's back again. Okay.
The New World copper culture. It arose around 1430 BC. They had flex burials in Wisconsin, burials in mounds, cremation, burial with stone artifacts, burial with copper daggers, burial with pottery. Number 8, bow-shaped pendants, hunter-gatherers, red ochre in the burial, rich guards, copper mining, used fire and water. Remember I told you about the mannequins in Virginia? The mannequins in Virginia. They spoke a Mandy language, and they used to be mining copper. You mine the copper, baby. Stop. I get so tired of hearing, you know, like Boyce Watkins. Oh, all these black people in Chicago. 55 schools. They didn't pass the test. They're so dumb. Oh, and all these black people in Baltimore. They didn't pass the test. Dumbass dummy. Just because you're a businessman, that don't mean ish. Our kids do not pass the test because our kids aren't being taught properly. Our kids in these school districts are led by people that don't love our children. They're led by people who are just there for money. It hurts me every day. It hurts me every day. Being an educator, knowing how well and how good our children learn, but we got people heading our various school districts that don't care about our children, don't care about their people. The only way we win is being B1, Black first. Until we began to recognize that we're Black first above all our nationalities, even our so-called Greek fraternity membership, we will be lost. And then people say, well, what's the answer? The answer is simple, B1. Wait a minute, Dr. Winters. You're saying the answer is B1? Yes. But that's too simple. Of course. It's simple to be unified by being Black first. But the European, he wants to keep us disunified. So he wants you to be nationality. That's why he needs Caremio. He needs Dane Calloway. Dane Calloway, he probably means well, but they don't understand. He's always talking about the white man, yet he's the white man's biggest weapon to keep niggas disunited. You saw on his latest videos, all these white people, oh, Dane Calloway, he teaching the right ish. He teaching the right ish. He ain't teaching you the right ish. He teaching you.
Wait a minute. Back up. White people love him?
Yeah, white people love Dane Calloway.
Okay, family, I'm going to say something publicly. I've never said on this show before. If white people love you, you'd have fucked up. Something's wrong. If white people, Europeans, love your scholarship, something is wrong. You're not B1. You're not Black enough. Because if you're truly about that first sight consciousness, first frequency life, about being B1, white people shouldn't even... Look at my channel. Look at the comments. There are no white people anywhere that says, yay, hoorah, Rev Shock. Now, they might in the background do it, I don't know, but... The work that we do, family, the science that we bring to you and to the community is all under the umbrella of B1. If white people love you, that means you've crossed over. That means you've compromised. And as a result of that, you're not only harming yourself, you're harming your own people and your own community.
And if anybody thinks I'm lying, look at this latest video, how they made the Indians Black or whatever. You'll see he shows in there about three to five white men talking about how great his research is. That's because his research divides us. His research does not unify us. The only thing that unifies us is recognize our African ancestry and respecting that we're Choctaw, respecting that we're Mongoloid. I mean, that we're Choctaw, Jews, Moors, Hebrews. Yes, respect that. But remember, we're B1 first. Again, in a sense, go to my Patreon to see the slides. These slides are going to be in my Patreon. You can find me on Twitter at Dr. Clyde Winters 8. And on YouTube, you can go to my YouTube channel, Dr. Clyde Winters. I want you to go to my YouTube channel and subscribe. Subscribe, and then you can see some of those nice videos. You can buy my books at Amazon.com. If you want to learn more about ancient Blacks in America, you can get David Imhotep's book, The First Americans Were Africans. You can get my book, Mandean Ancient American. I talk a little bit more about the Mandean influence.
Oh, is this true? Hold on, Doc. Melvin Reed just put in the chat. Is Dane Calloway's wife is white?
I don't know about his wife. I don't think his wife.
Can somebody confirm that for me? Because that's what. Oh my. Okay. Oh, that says everything. If that's true, that says everything. That explains it.
I don't know if his wife is white. I don't know. I know him and his wife. They do a lot of work together. Then get my book, African Empires in Ancient America. Melvin, can you...
She's not. Okay. Some more just said she's not white.
Yeah, I didn't...
So I mean, I don't give a damn either way or the other, but I've never watched one of his programs. But just, you know, when we're looking at that concept of CAIDS, there are different levels to it. And obviously, he's dealing with that.
And see, he, like I said, is that he talks about Flecker. He talks about how they began to label all the Indians as Black. Yeah, that's cool. But he doesn't understand that white people like him because he wants us to return to the same thing that allowed them to defeat us in the past. They defeated us in the past because we were so nationalistic. They put the Creek against the Yamasee. The Yamasee the Yamasi against the damn Cherokee, and the Cherokee kissing everybody ass and being Uncle Tom. But Cherokee are weird people. I shouldn't say that because my wife, you know, when I was talking to Dr. Short yesterday, he was talking about all the Cherokees who died and had about multiple wives, and had maybe 50 to 100 100 children, and they were proud of it. And then I know that my wife's father, Nate, he talked about the fact that his father was a Cherokee, and his father left his mother, and then he made some other family. So it's a Cherokee tradition. You know, it's a Cherokee tradition of having a lot of baby mamas. So they marry you not, but it might be illegal since they.
Yeah, but we'll marry you, but you won't be the only one. Yeah,
that's right.
That's crazy. God dang.
But anyway, that's just an aside. And you can get my book, African Empires in Ancient America. If you want to find, as I told you before, there's a tripartite origin of Black people. Black people are a combination of Native Americans, Black Native Americans, Europeans, and also Africans. Every Aboriginal American FBA should have my book. We're not just Africans. And this book, it costs a little money, but you can also get it through Kindle. But this book, it costs a little bit more money because it's got color pictures in it. It's on white paper. This should be in every Aboriginal FBA's home, so that if anybody coming in and say you not Indian, they can show those pictures. They can show those pictures in my book. We're not just Africans. Also, my book, The Black Non-Builders of America. You can order all these books at Amazon.com. And then I just wrote a new book. And my new book is Pathfinder, Clyde Winters in Search of the Roots of Rifle Centricity, a memoir. In Pathfinders, I talk about how I began to research Black history. It talks about my life growing up. It talks about my wife. It talks about some of the things that helped me to become researchers. And I'm quite sure that if you get this book, Pathfinder, Clyde Winters in Search of the Roots of the Afrocentrism in America, a memoir, it'll help you to understand, in a sense, how to do research and learn more about our history. Also my Black History Gem Essays, Volume 1, it also has some of that discussion. But one day we may discuss my book, Pathfinder.
We are. I want to do a special show on this, Doc. This is, I don't think the people know how serious this book is, but this is a serious, serious book. This is your life history. This is your work. This is how you came to become Dr. Clyde Winters. So yeah, we're gonna have a great celebration on that. Yes, sir.
We'll do that one day down the road. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Okay. If you want to check out more about Aboriginal FBA history, get Black History Gems, Volume 1. Thank you.
Wow, 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 wowee. As always, this crazy man who never takes his medication, who doesn't get enough sleep, comes out and he just wows us and pows us every single time. This was amazing. Now, because of the research that you're doing, like you said, you're spending about $500 a month on books and research. That's about right. I'm probably a little bit over that because I have so many other books that I have to learn and work with to keep up on all the technology or whatever. But I can easily say anywhere from $500 to $1,000 a month is basically the budget just for our research personally alone, what we bring to the community. So you're absolutely right on that fact. And I'm looking forward to the part three because I know you. Well, you're kind of like the number one scholar that comes on with new, fresh, updated research rather than the regurgitated stuff that we all know and have been exposed to. So the fact that there's going to be a part three of this coming down the pipe, that's going to be fantastic.
Yeah, well, see, the part three, I'm going to talk about specific Black Indian nationalities. I'm going to talk about our faith in God, how they felt about Amma. We'll talk about, in a sense, some of the cultural experiences and how some of these things were organized. But I want everybody who listened to today's broadcast, I want you to understand that whenever you see some black people running around the teepee, they're trying to teach you a culture that was not our culture.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See, you know, like I was telling this brother yesterday, and he was talking about I was explaining to him about that many East Africans came over here. And he said, You don't know that. He said, you don't know that. I said, what's the number one word in the English language that came from East Africa? He said, I don't know. Khaki. That's a Swahili word. Khaki pants, all that. The khaki is a Swahili word. And that came from the fact that the American slave trader, he couldn't go steal slaves from West Africa because the British dominated that. Since the British dominated slave trade in West Africa, he went around to East Africa, around Mozambique. And that's where he brought a lot of slaves from Mozambique and Malagasy. That's why a lot of black people have that Asiatic cast, because a lot of FBAs were sold into slavery from Malagasy. And that's why they have, in the sense that sometimes that's cast. But again, we have a very unique history. But
absolutely. One thing
I want you to remember, part one, what did I talk about? Part one, I talked about the stone walls we built. I talked about the pyramids we built. I talked about how we've been here since 130,000 years ago. Part two, I tried to talk about our science and engineering that we did with the Maung culture and how we expanded that culture. Part three is going to be about the tribes. But next week, it'll be me and Dr. Short. And Dr. Short, we're going to talk about American Maroon, and maybe I can even get Dr. Short to talk about some of the things that he knows, because Dr. Short, he has a very interesting family background. As I said, his family has been in Virginia and the Carolinas even before the European got here. So his history is very interesting. But again, like I said, we're going to talk about American Maroon. I hope all of you will go and look at American Maroon and support the movie, because remember, you guys are the ones who got me in the movie.
You're right. Exactly. So when you show it, do a screen, say, hey, that's my Baba. I did that. I was a part of that.
Because it was you guys. It was you guys who tracked Tariq down, and y'all got on all of his different channels, and he had to finally say, I'm gonna have to flew out, Dr. Winters, and talk. And so again, I thank you again, you guys, for getting Tariq Nasheed to want to include me in the American Maroon. But I'm gonna tell you, you gotta go see American Maroon. Okay, you can go. It's on FBAstream.com. You know. You may not want, you're going to have to pay $8.98 maybe for a monthly subscription. But remember, you can get the monthly subscription and you can keep it, because he's got all his other movies on it. Or you can just get it to see me.
Love it. But, I love it.
And
I love it.
But again, like I said, we're in this together, family. And we're in this together because, see, you inspire me. You inspire me to want to do this. You inspire me to come here. You know, you guys are so good to us. That's one of the reasons that Reverend Matthews take the time. I mean, Reverend Matthews is a busy man, and yet he takes the time on Sunday to talk to the family. He takes the time on Sunday to help enlighten us, to help us, in a sense, to find a way to get away from all of these petty aggressions that we suffer from every day. Yes.
Yes.
We suffer from a lot of petty aggressions. Going out into the European world and them just trying to attack us and bring us down.
Mm-hmm.
And you moms and you dads, you got to show these videos to your kids.
Facts. Yes, sir.
You show these videos to your kids so your kids can know what they can really do. They're not dumb.
Nope.
They're not dumb. Nope. But they don't know their history. And that's one of the reasons why, if you notice, people like DeSantis down in Florida, he's trying to rewrite or negate any black history. He doesn't want us to be who we are. He doesn't want us to be all that we can be.
Mm-hmm.
He don't want us to know that nothing is wrong with us. Something they did to us.
Woo. Woo. Preach it and teach it, my brother. Absolutely. Family, we have to give thanks to this brother. We have to give thanks to Baba, I'll start to call you Baba Kabas, Baba Clyde, because over this last year, now we're in our second season with Dr. Winters, we've never seen a man like this before. We've never seen a scholar like this before. It's a really exciting time to be one. It's an exciting time to be Black first. It's an exciting time to be first frequency, first sight consciousness. This is an exciting time because it is our time. This is our time to rise and shine. This is our time to correct the history and the wrongs that was done to us. But we can't correct anything if we don't have the consciousness for it. We can't move ourselves forward if we don't have a collective understanding and consciousness to do that. If you're not first sight consciousness, you haven't done this work, you're not studying the materials, then you're going to be more part of the problem than part of the solution, right? B1 is about ancestry, and then that ancestry, that's first sight consciousness and first frequency. And that's who we are and what we do and what we be. So I'm going to give thanks and angst to Dr. Clyde Winters and to all of you, because all of you made us, right? I come out here every day or every other day, every week, and whatever, all the shows I've done for the last 10 years, interviewing all the scholars and all of that kind of stuff. And you guys have grown with me. You have loved me through all of these hard times that we've gone through together. And, you know, it's a very special time. And so there's some things coming down the pike that's just getting ready to blow your mind. So I'm really looking forward to that. I see my brother Yoshimad is in the chat. Yoshimad, if you see my background, that's Yoshimad. So y'all need to get some Yoshimad. His information is also in the description with Dr. Clyde Winters. I also put in the chat, family, and it's also in the description where you can get all of Dr. Clyde's books, PDFs, everything. Go to his chat. His YouTube channel is in the description. So go there. His Patreon is in the description. So you can go there. Everything Dr. Clyde Winters, I have come to realize we just need to absorb. And we probably want to do something crazy. I probably want to, you know what I'm going to probably start doing? I'm probably going to start a book club based on Dr. Clyde Winters. And so every month we'll get together and we'll say, okay, we're going to devour this book. And I'll probably, I'll have to beg him, but I'll probably have Dr. Winters come on and say, hey, Doc, can you have a comment on this book that you just wrote? Go ahead, my beloved elder.
And also, A brother registered for the class this week.
And
so we're already 8 weeks in the class. And I talked to him, and he said he didn't really understand what we were doing. But the point, and he wanted to learn out more about different historical phases and things like that. But please don't sign up for the course this late, because you know we've been doing this for 8 weeks, and you guys in a sense can't get the full understanding of the course. You know, unless you begin at the beginning. We're going to do another course probably in August. We're going to, have another class in August, you know, because we're doing overtime. Because
you might have to do it sooner than that, Doc. There's a high demand for your research course. There's a high demand. So we'll figure it out. But, we'll figure it out. But you guys, I think, you know, what has happened, Doc, is that people know you the truth. They know you the truth. They trust you. They trust me. They know that we're not coming with no bull-s. We're not trying to gank people out of money and then leave them hanging. We're giving them honest, secure, transformational information that they can now do. We're creating superheroes. They're getting a superpower by learning how to do research, learning how to read it, and just the fact that, like you were talking about Dane Calloway earlier. Well, if I didn't know Clyde Winters, hadn't gone through your course, I don't know how to do primary research, yeah, I'm going to believe a Dan Calloway or whoever is, because I don't know. I don't have the skill sets to be able to read between the lines and know the truth. And this is how we all get duped once again. So with your class, your advanced research class, you're teaching us beyond the PhD level. You're teaching us not only how to counter the narrative, but how to decipher the hidden codes, the hidden words, and the hidden agenda of white scholarship. So it's not just enough to be able to write a paper, peer-reviewed paper or an article. You also have to know how to read them and how to pull out and see if it's BS in there, or there's lies or dosha or whatever you want to call that. That's a superpower. You're the only person on earth, Baba, that does this, that is doing this. And I think the community over the last year and now however many months we're in, what are we? Oh, gosh, we're in March. So a year and 3 months. You have literally changed the game. Well, it's been longer than that, hasn't it? A little bit.
We started in September. So it's been a year and 6 months.
Oh, my gosh. A year and 6 months. That's right. That's exactly right. Okay.
And we've only missed two shows.
Wow.
We've only missed two weeks out of 2 years.
So give us something for good attendance too, family. Go to our Patreon and sign up just for good attendance. God damn. We're showing up for class. So I just want to give thanks and all seriousness to everyone and all of you and Dr. Winters. And AMA is always in the mix. We don't do anything without AMA's permission. We don't move without knowing that it is in the spirit, nature, and consciousness of AMA and Ma'at. So we're safe, we're clear, but we got this. We have figured a lot of this stuff out. Nothing's wrong with us. Something happened to us. This is a signal interruption. A frequency is what they are. We are a frequency. We are the first frequency. We're the only frequency. We're the only frequency that cannot die. We're the only frequency that cannot die. We multiply. We might lose and move our bodies from one dimension to the next, what they call death. But we don't die. We transcend and we become ancestors. And as a result of that first consciousness and being in that first consciousness, that's what Ma'at is about. That's what we do. I want you to know that you have a superpower because AMA is the superpower. You're made in the image and likeness of AMA. There's a resilience inside of you. There's coding inside of you to overcome any micro, macro aggression from any other group, any other species. We are the masters of the universe, not just of the earth. So with that, Doc, we haven't played with you in a little while. Hey, Doc, why don't you do the affirmation of power? There he goes. So as we calm ourselves and give thanks and angst to our beloved AMA and our beloved Dr. Clyde Winters, we seal nothing is wrong with us. Something happened to us. We seal this energy. We seal this first sight, first frequency consciousness by simply repeating, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
Therefore, I must be one with the only one.
Therefore, I must be one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
And so it is. Asheo.
Asheo.